Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to our SIF seminar. I think Kim will reconnect shortly to properly cast. Since this seminar is completely online due to obvious reasons, I think we need to keep our microphones mute at all times, not to allow any background noise. If you wish to ask a question, feel free to use the raise your hand function or message me or Kim if you wish, or if you happen to have any questions afterwards, feel free to send them to Kim emails or my email. My name is Makita, by the way. I am a legal researcher at CTIP, Research Group of Keulen. SIF seminars are interdisciplinary seminars organized by CTIP, DistriNet, and COSIC research groups of Keulen, and we had a small break while conducting those seminars, but today we resume with a very interesting topic by Kim Wötz, and the topic is on Linden, and specifically Linden Go. Linden is a wonderful invention, I would say, because I worked with it personally and I applied it in one of the European projects. I think you will find it interesting as well. Today, Kim will present Linden Go, which is a toolkit for lightweight privacy threat modeling. And it is in a very engaging way. The Linden Go works in a very engaging way. So it's not just plain text or some boring schemes. No, it is indeed very interesting way of learning and modeling privacy threats. In the first part, Kim will look into threat modeling in general, introduce you to the concepts in case someone is not familiar with it, and then explain the main principles of Linden, because Linden is an acronym. And then she will proceed to explaining what Linden Go specifically is. I don't know whether Kim has reconnected. Kim, are you here?
Yes, I am here. Are you seeing anything of my screen now?
Okay. No.
You can maybe check in the address bar of your browser if there's anything.
Yes, I am sharing. Let me see if I put it on presenter view. Anything?
No, I'm afraid no.
No. Then I will share my entire screen. Hopefully that works. I had to do some stuff with my privacy setting.
Make sure to apply Linden.
Yeah.
Screen.
Are you seeing my
screen? Yes.
Yes, no, we see ourselves.
Are you seeing my presentation now?
Indeed. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. And you're hearing me?
Yes. Okay. One remark before you start. Kim, I will record this session.
Sure.
It's already recording, actually, but I'll cut off the beginning part. I'll record the session, and I'll also record the Q&A afterwards. If during the talk, for whatever reason, I don't know, you say something, whatever, that you want us to cut out later on, you just tell Sophie or me, and I will make that happen.
Okay. Perfect.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, mute myself and give the floor back to you.
Okay. So thank you all for joining. I kind of missed my own intro by Mikita, so sorry about that. So I'm Kim Wötz. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at DistriNet, and my research mainly focuses on privacy threat modeling, which is part of software engineering in general. I'm also interested in data protection and security. And if you want to get in touch, please do by mailing me or sending me something on Twitter or LinkedIn or whatever. So today, I will talk about Linden privacy threat modeling. Before I dive into those details, I will give some insights on threat modeling. And the final part of the session is about Linden Go, which is the newest edition, which is the more lightweight approach to privacy threat modeling. Mm-hmm. So why threat modeling? Well, basically, you want to avoid problems. If you drive a car, everybody who drives a car does its very best to avoid situations like this picture. You follow the speed limits, kind of. Take your car for regular checkups. You are very attentive when you drive, and you drive defensively because you really do not want to have this kind of crashes. And the same applies to software. Fortunately, we see less and less the approach of, well, let's wait until a problem occurs and let's tackle it then. So privacy and security by design is really essential to tackle all problems or security and privacy requirements early on in the development lifecycle. And threat modeling assists there, because threat modeling is basically thinking about what can go wrong so you can fix it before it actually happens. And it's actually something we do on a daily basis already, sometimes without even realizing we're doing it. For instance, when we leave the house, you lock the door. Why? Well, because you have been thinking about, well, we want to avoid any burglaries. So did we close our windows? Did we lock our doors? And the same we do, or we should do, for software. So one of the steps of threat modeling is thinking about what can go wrong. But to do so, you first need to know what you're working on. You need to understand the software system you're analyzing. So similar to the example of the burglars, you think about your house, of all the entry points, all the windows and the doors. For software, you need to have an understanding of the system itself, of all the different components there. And each of those elements, each of those interactions, each of those components, you want to systematically analyze and think about what can go wrong. Of course, identifying the problems is a first step. Probably you also want to fix them, so you want to think about what you're going to do about it. And then finally, you need to know whether you've done an acceptable job, so you will reflect on the work you've done so far, see if you need to reiterate certain parts or want to zoom into certain details. These are not the steps I came up with. These are well-known steps described by Adam Shostak, who's kind of the threat modeling guru. If you're interested in threat modeling, I really advise his book. So this is really high level, these steps. In the next part of the session, I will zoom into those for Linden specifically. So let me first introduce Linden Privacy Threat Modeling Framework. So it is a method that provides systematic support to elicit and mitigate privacy threats in software systems. So you want to do that early on in the development lifecycle. Once you are able to have a sketch of your system, you can threat model. And the method is inspired by STRIDE. STRIDE is a security threat modeling approach created 20 years ago by Microsoft. It's quite well known, widespread. And basically, Linden is has the same structure, has the same method. So that's the first part. It's a method. It provides support on how to tackle this problem in a systematic way. But of course, you need to know what you're thinking about, what privacy is. If I just say, well, systematically think about what can go wrong for each element in the system, that's really vague. So Linden also provides a privacy knowledge base, which is categorized according to these seven threat categories, which together form the acronym Linden. In the next slides, I will zoom into each of those in a bit more detail. So Linden was created about 10 years ago, and we're actually quite happy to see that it has been gaining some importance. There are some academic citations. But most exciting for me, I think, is the fact that it's really being used in industry. It's also being included in the ISO on privacy engineering. It's being included in the privacy by design opinion by EPS and so on. So we're very excited to see that this thing is actually being applied in practice. Okay, now let's dive into some more details. So these are the seven categories. The first four are the more what we call hard privacy categories. And then we have one we borrowed from security. And then the final two, on awareness and on compliance, are more soft categories. And I like to explain them in a less technical way by using some animal pictures. So bear with me. So linkability and identifiability are actually quite related. Identifiability means that within a set of subjects, you can sufficiently distinguish the item of interest or the person you're looking for. So in this picture, if I talk about the yellow duck, you all know which one I'm talking about without knowing, I don't know, his name or his DNA sequence or whatever. So that's one of the threat categories, identifiability. And linkability is actually quite related to it. Linkability means that you can link multiple data items, multiple properties or descriptions or attributes related to the same data subject. And by linking all those items together, you come closer to identifiability. So for instance, if I'm talking about, I know something about a woman, then I have like 50% of the entire population that the anonymity set is. If I know something about a person in Belgium, then I really have no clue what the population in Belgium is, but it's a lot smaller. If you combine those two properties, then you have half of Belgium's population. If you're talking about somebody who works at Distrinet, then you have, I don't know, 70. If you combine those, well, maybe just the female and the Distrinet employee, then it already really narrows down the anonymity set and so on. So by linking all different data items together, which on first hand sight seem kind of generic and not violating or not identifying anybody, by linking those concepts together, you will quickly go to identifiability or at least increase the risk of identifiability. Then we have a different kind of linkability, which is not linking items of interest about the same data subject, but linking items of different data subjects about the same property. So in this example, we have all dogs that are linked together to the same human. In practice, that can be, it's mainly a societal problem, not so much an individual risk. So the non-privacy violating example is that in a shop, your data is being collected and it shows that people who tend to buy hot dog sausages also need to buy buns, so they are put together. That's fine. But if an insurance company can deduce information from people in the same neighborhoods who have a higher risk of a certain disease and therefore increase the fees, then, well, that can be a problem. So that's a different kind of linkability. Then there's non-repudiation. So that means that you cannot deny that you have said something, done something, or so on. For people who work in security, this is an interesting one, because for security, non-repudiation is actually a property you often want to have. But for privacy, you might want to have plausible deniability. For instance, denying who you voted for in an online voting system. Then there's detectability. That means without having actually access to the data, you know it exists. In this picture, without actually seeing what is behind this leaf, you can be pretty sure it's a snail. A more technical example is when you send a query to a database and there are, I don't know, three matches, but you don't have access to the data items that you requested. Depending on the access control policy, the database can return the result saying there are three matches, but you are not actually allowed to see what it is. Or you are denied full access, or it's returned at zero is found. If the database already show you that there are three matches, even without having access to that information itself, knowing it exists, that's detectability. And if that is like a sensitive query about somebody in a rehab facility, about, I don't know, political views or whatever, that can be a problem because you can deduce more information just by knowing something exists. Then there's disclosure of information. As I mentioned before, this is a security property, but it's also very important for privacy. It's related to access control. It's related to encryption. It basically means you want to protect your assets and you want to control access to it. So it's about confidentiality. And then there are the two more soft categories, which are unawareness and non-compliance. And I already want to show you their Linden Go properties. So we kind of revised these categories a bit in the latest variants in Linden Go. And their unawareness is related mainly to data subject rights. So it's about the right to information, but also the right to object and the right to basically control your own data. And non-compliance is more related to the general processing principles like minimization and storage limitation and so on. Of course, Linden is not the only categorization of privacy properties or threats in this case. You also have the triad by Hansen, which is unlinkability, intervenability, and transparency, which is kind of the CIA counterpart. And NIST has a similar taxonomy, predictability, manageability, and disassociability. Both can be easily mapped to Linden, by the way. And of course, there are some others which are worth looking into if you're interested in privacy properties. Okay, so that was in a nutshell already the different categories. If there are any questions so far, please let me know. If not, I just continue. So now you know what we mean with privacy. When we're talking about Linden, let me walk you through the different steps. So these are basically the first three steps of the overall steps I showed before. So what are you working on? You need a model. What are we going to do about it? What can go wrong, which is the threat elicitation. And then you want to manage the threats. So these are the steps. And Linden also includes knowledge support. So using the classification into the seven categories to identify threats, Linden provides a mapping table and a threat taxonomy in the form of a threat tree catalog. I will show all of these in the next slides. And also to manage the threats, there is some privacy knowledge support for finding suitable strategies and solutions. But so the first thing you need to do is to model the system. You need to know what you're working on. And for this, we also use a data flow diagram similar to Stride. So for those who are familiar with Stride, for those who do security threat modeling, they will typically use Stride and have created a data flow diagram or something similar. So Linden easily aligns to that. So this picture is a very high-level, naive representation of a social network where you have a user that connects to the portal, which has some backend service and some database where all the social network data is collected. And in between, you have the arrows, which are the data flows. So a data flow diagram is really a very easy representation of a system, focusing on how the information flows through it. And I think that's also one of the benefits. You don't need very complex descriptions. You can have kind of this sketch-like representation, which is, at least according to me, also quite easy to understand for people who are less technical. Okay, so when you have this model, you know you want to analyze each of those elements in a systematic way, and you want to think what can go wrong for each of the Linden categories. And for this, Linden has a mapping template. So basically, you have each DFD element type should be examined for each Linden category, but there are some exceptions because unawareness, well, that's only an entity who can be aware or unaware. So certain categories for data stores and flows and processes, for instance, that does not apply. So what happens is you instantiate this mapping template for the model, and you will get this big table with a row for each of the DFD elements. And then this mapping table becomes the guide to systematically analyze your system, and it will also show the progress of your analysis. So each of the axes in the table should be examined. For instance, we have linkability of the social network database. But how should you think about what can go wrong? Well, that is the additional privacy knowledge Linden provides. There are threat trees, which are the most common attack paths for that combination of Linden threat category and DFD element type. So for each of the axes, you will look at the overview of what can go wrong, analyze whether that applies to that specific element, and if so, you will document it. And you continue to do that until there are no axes left in the table. And that way, you have great traceability of the entire privacy assessment process, which is now especially great if you want to prove that you have applied privacy by design, for instance, for GDPR accountability. So I'm rushing through it, I know, but I also want to talk about Linden Go. So let me continue with the final step, where you want to resolve the problems you have identified. So ideally, you will need to prioritize the threats. You will get a list of, I don't know, 20, 30 more threats. It is highly unlikely that you will be able to mitigate them all. And in any case, you will need to have some priority there. The trick here is also to not have this done by only somebody with a technical background, but this should be done with somebody with a legal background, a DPO, somebody who has a background in data protection, because from a technical perspective, a threat can be acceptable, while from a legal perspective, this can be a very big risk. So how do you assess risk? From a very high level view, this is the combination of the impact the threat has and the likelihood that it occurs. There are more fancy ways to calculate it. I'm not sure whether my colleague Laurens will talk about it in one of the upcoming STIF seminars. But in any case, he has more information about that. So what will you do? Typically, well, you can accept the risk, but usually you want to try to mitigate it. but how can you mitigate it? There are so many solutions out there, so many algorithms and patterns and what are there. So how can you find the one that is most suited? Well, Linden created kind of a layer on top of those solutions, which are called mitigation strategies, that will help you zoom in or scope the set of solutions that you can use. And those strategies are linked to the threat trees from the catalog. So if you have identified a threat based on the trees in the catalog, then you already know which strategies are most suited to mitigate a threat. So this is the mitigation strategies classification, where we make a distinction between preventing things to go wrong, so concealing the association, and then guarding the association. So once the data has already been shared, how you can minimize the consequences of the sharing. So there's a link between the threat trees and these strategies. And I think I removed an example from my slides, which would have been useful now. So for instance, when you're talking about identifiability of a data flow, which can be because you have shared too much personal information as a user to the backend system, then you want to protect before you actually share that information, you want to protect the transactional data, so the actual data that is being communicated, which can be done by removing some data, by hiding the data, by replacing or by generalizing it. And then those strategies are mapped to an overview of privacy enhancing techniques. And based on the strategy you selected, you can find corresponding solutions in there. Yes. So that was kind of a quick rush through how Linden should be applied. I will go to the more lightweight approach of this in the next slides, but I want to have a brief intermezzo, because when I'm talking about privacy threat modeling, two of the main questions I get are, yeah, but we already do security threat modeling, so we'll be fine. And the other one we get mainly from industries, okay, so now we are compliant if we do this thing. So I already want to tackle those two misconceptions. So security and privacy threat modeling, yes, they share a lot, but it's still a different approach and it requires a different mindset. Where security is about protecting the data as a whole, privacy is focusing on protecting personal data. So it's not about protecting the assets of the company, which is security. It's really about thinking about what can go wrong with respect of to the data subject or data subjects. So you really need to stop thinking about protecting your assets, but thinking about what that means for the people who are involved in the actual data. So that also means that where security is about protecting against external attackers, privacy is not just about protecting against attackers, but it's also often about some internal misbehavior. And one other difference is that for security, it's often about, or at least confidentiality, it's about preventing unauthorized access. So you're talking about data as a whole, you want to encrypt the entire flow or encrypt the entire database or whatever. Privacy can be more on individual items and attributes. It's really about limiting the consequences of what you can do with that personal data. So that might be that you remove certain attributes from an entire set of data rather than doing something with the data set as a whole. So in summary, it's related. If you know security threat modeling, great. It will be very easy to start doing privacy threat modeling, but approach it with a different mindset. Think from the data subject perspective. And then the difference between compliance and privacy threat modeling. So for data protection compliance, you often need to do a data protection impact assessment, which is risk-oriented, similar to privacy threat modeling. I called it model-driven, which what I mean is you need to have a description of the system, or at least of all the data that are being processed and about the processing activities. For privacy threat modeling, you also need an overview of the system about how the data flows through the system. So that's very related, but of course, the approach is different. From the legal perspective, you look at legal roles, controllers, processors, processing operations, purposes, compatibility assessments. So that's really something that you need help from a lawyer. And privacy threat modeling focuses primarily on the architectural or technical part, where you're trying to assess whether those appropriate technical measures that are required by GDPR are in place. So it's really about the by design part. So in essence, you need both. And it's actually quite exciting because there is a lot of overlap between these two. So we actually have a research project collaboration of CTIP and Distrinet, where we are looking into combining this legal and architectural assessment. Okay, so that was the intermezzo. Let's get back to Linden. So in a nutshell, what is Linden? What is privacy threat modeling? It provides systematic support to elicit and mitigate privacy threats. And because it's so, by using that mapping table, as I showed quickly, you have this traceability, accountability, and because you have that extensive catalog of things that can go wrong, you also have a high degree of thoroughness, so that's great. But you still require quite some expertise to really grasp all the privacy information. And because it is so thorough, it's also quite complex, and it might give some friction to execute. So what do we see in practice? That people who apply Linden actually apply the mnemonic. So they just brainstorm by thinking about the high-level Linden categories, so linkability, identifiability, non-repudiation, and so on. And that's great, because obviously, that reduces a lot of complexity, a lot of friction. But there is a downside, because it actually requires more expertise, because you don't have that support from the knowledge base or from the method. So you also lose the traceability and the thoroughness. It really all depends on the expertise of the analyst performing it. So that made us think, how can we assist analysts in getting this more lightweight, low friction, low complexity approach, but still getting quite the level of thoroughness and traceability? So we really want to lower the threshold, so lower the required expertise, but still keep it lightweight. So we came up with these requirements, which I think are kind of straightforward. So we want a simple method, but still we want it comprehensive. We want to have it covering the entire system. And we actually also want to invest in a collaborative approach, because in essence, threat modeling should not be something you do in isolation. It really requires collaboration. You will need an interdisciplinary team, hopefully. Get everybody involved and think about what can go wrong. So if the method can reflect that would be great. And of course, the knowledge should also be understandable. And it would actually help if there are some criteria that can help the analyst quickly decide on whether or not a description actually applies to the element or to the system that is being analyzed. So these requirements did not just fall from the sky. They're actually based on industry feedback and a number of empirical studies that we conducted throughout the past years. And again, we looked at the security threat modeling community, where there is the elevation of privilege card game. There are some privacy extensions for that, and so on. And this resulted in Linden Go. Linden Go is a toolkit, actually a card deck, that supports a lightweight collaborative approach to privacy threat modeling. So how was this created? Well, as I mentioned, we found inspiration from the elevation of privilege card game, which is basically a gamification of Stride, so the security threat modeling approach by Microsoft. And what we really liked about elevation of privilege was the card representation and the collaborative aspect. But so those cards only had like one sentence or a couple of words describing the potential threat. And especially for privacy, we had the feeling that that was not sufficient, that it really needed to be a lot more extensive, the description. So what also was changed compared to the full Linden, where there were about 100 leaf notes. So if you, I showed one example tree from the threat tree catalog, each of the leaf notes in those trees actually describe a potential privacy threat type. But of course, going through 100 of those can be challenging. So we reduced the scope to now 35, which does not mean that we just threw away all of those others. We indeed discarded some low priority threats, but we also combined some related threat types and basically captured the more high level overarching threat and included some examples there to make the difference. And another update we've done compared to the original Linden was alignment with GDPR principles, as I showed before, because now an awareness captures data subject rights and non-compliance captures the privacy, the data protection principles. So how does such a card look like? Well, you have some obvious fields, an identifier, a summary, a title. Examples really help. We have some information about impact and consequences, so to help you assess why this threat is important, and some additional information. But what I think is one of the advantages here is the applicability questions. So each card has two questions to assess whether the threat type applies to the system or to the element that you're analyzing, and whether that would be a problem. There's also information about the threat source, because as I mentioned before, for privacy, it's not only about an attacker that wants to violate someone's privacy, it's often also an organizational misbehavior that you want to tackle. And then we also have hotspots. Hotspots describe in a high-level way the element or component in the model where the threat type might occur. For those familiar with data flow diagrams, this is actually similar to a DFD interaction where some additional constraints are added. So these are the generic hotspots where you have inbound flow, so where data enters the system. You can also have threats on outbound flows, where the data leaves the system. It can be part of data storage or data retrieval, or more the processes, so the, let's say, computational units of the system. So these are the five main hotspot categories, and then there are more detailed descriptions of it. For instance, you have a subtype of inbound flow where there is a human actor involved, so where a human actor is the sender or receiver of the flow. You can also have more specific information on the types of data that are being communicated and so on. So these hotspots really help scope the places in the model where you need to look. So where in the original Stride and Linden trees, you would have just linkability of a flow. In that case, you would need to look at these six arrows here. Now this card, which is about identifying an inbound data thread, is, as the thread describes, about inbound personal data flow. So it's quite easy to link that card to the specific flow in the model. So that also helps and speeds up the elicitation process. So how does it work? What are the instructions? Well, you gather a group of people, preferably 3 to 5 or 6 at most. And then the first person picks a card, thinks about what can go wrong in the system you're analyzing, and ideally identifies a threat. If a threat is identified, you document it. And then you continue, you go around, and each of the participants thinks about what can go wrong. You can also discuss it. And if a new threat occurs, then of course you document it again. And you continue to go full circle until nobody identifies new threats an entire round. So you know you have fully covered this card, and then the next person picks a new card and the elicitation continues. So that was the main set of instructions. We also described some variants where you don't go full circle, but only the person who draws the card thinks about and elicits a threat, and then you continue. You can also time box it or only limit it to a small set of cards. You can make it more fun by really turning into a game and earning points for each identified threat. You can play it or use it by yourself, more as input for an individual exercise, so more as a catalog, as a reference. Or you can freestyle, and as I described in the beginning, where people focus on the acronym without going into detail, you can only use the Lin and Go category cards, which I show in the next slide, to brainstorm about what can go wrong. Again, it's important to note that this freestyle version still requires sufficient privacy expertise to pull this off successfully. So in addition to the threat type cards, which I showed before, we also have these category cards for each of the six Lin and Go categories. We explicitly did not include disclosure of information, which is a security category, and which should be covered anyway, because you also need to have a security threat assessment. So we really wanted to focus on privacy-specific threats, because if you include security here, experience has shown us that people are more familiar or feel more at ease about thinking about security threats, so they will really start focusing again on security, and we really want to have privacy to take priority here. So these category cards can be used as background information, but they can also be used in that freestyle exercise where you have at least a bit more information than just that one word linkability. You have some background information, and each of the cards also shows the hotspots where the threats mainly occur. So we launched Lin and Go in January. We've had a trial run before that, of which we used the inputs to create the version we have now. After release, there was a student exercise at Ulm University where we received some feedback from, and we also already received some feedback from industry professionals. And the overall agreement they had was that Linden Go is a lot easier to apply than the Linden Threat Trees, because the cards, both the cards and the approach, are easy to understand. Mainly the applicability questions are most valued, and also the examples help to understand. There are some varying opinions on hotspots, where some people say it's great to have this more high level focused representation. Other people, mainly those who are more familiar with security threat modeling, say they prefer to have the regular data flow diagram references. We also got some bonus points for the collaborative aspect, and we had several people giving feedback that it really helps also for an interdisciplinary team to join and to talk about the same properties, although you approach it from a different perspective. We already received some suggestions for improvement, such as some people who want to have more support on how to actually document the threats when you apply Linden Go. And also some people really want to see some suggestions or selection support for solutions included in the cards. Yeah, we're still collecting feedback from industry as we speak. This is one of the latest reviews I received, because I think last week or 2 weeks ago, Linden Go was one of the featured games in an article about data protection gamification. So it's really nice to see that this is also being spread and being used in practice. So we will continue to collect feedback from industry and use this to, in the future, update Linden Go and the entire Linden framework. So it's all freely available. You can find it all on the website, which is linden.org. There are some card decks available. If you're interested, contact me, but I think both at CTIP and at, I'm not sure how many there are at COSIC, but at CTIP there are definitely a couple that are already there. But we really want to have your feedback, so if you have any comments, please let me know. So some resources about things I mentioned before, our Linden website. If you want to get started with threat modeling, I highly recommend Adam's book and some references on privacy engineering and privacy by design in general. Okay, so are there any questions?